Hello, everyone. Welcome. As you're joining, we are going to wait just about 5 minutes for people to kind of keep joining, but we're glad you're here. And if you have questions, feel free to start adding them to the chat, and I can take them as I see them pop up once we do kind of wait this 5 minutes as people join. And I will say hello again. My name is Lynn Walsh. Sorry, I didn't say that in the beginning. I'm the assistant director at Trusting News. And at Trusting News, our goal is to help journalists rebuild trust with the public. And primarily, we do that through helping journalists be transparent about their work, talk about their goals, their mission. And so, specifically with this session, as you've been learning in module one, that means talking about what your goals are with your election coverage, getting on the record, because we don't do that. People often make assumptions about our decision making, and those assumptions are often negative and lead to distrust. So, trying to combat that distrust through that transparency and getting on the record. So, hopefully, there are lots of questions I can answer about as you've been going through the course so far, or just general questions you might have about building trust with your election coverage. And when I do see a hand raised, I do want to wait just 3 more minutes. And Nana, if I'm saying that correctly, I can come to you first, though. But let's wait just 3 more minutes. We want to make sure we get people kind of joining here. The other thing I will say is this is also recorded and will be available to you in module one. But if we'll wait 3 more minutes and then Nana, and I hope I'm saying that right, I will come to you. I'm glad you have a question.
Hey Lynn, it's Jessel here. Since we have a few minutes,
Hey.
would you want to tell us a little bit about how you came to this work and sort of like what sort of inspired you? Because you come from a career in journalism and also teaching journalism as well. And how you got like sort of like made that jump and what like what motivated you and drove you to do this work?
Yeah, I can talk a little bit about that. Thanks, Jessel. Hi. And Nana, if your audio is not coming up, you can feel free to put your question there in the chat too while I'm talking, because I can still take that question first. So, my background primarily has been working as an investigative journalist in broadcast, so primarily television. And I've primarily worked in the United States, but all around the country. So, I've worked in Ohio, Texas, Florida, and California, which is where I'm currently based. For me, I really see journalism as a public service. I believe that information is really powerful and people deserve and have a right to information. And we kind of are that, we're the people that provide that, because when people are working and they have kids and they have families and they have all these things they're dealing with, they don't have time to go to council meetings. They don't have time to kind of learn about or keep up with all the content that's being pushed out. And so our job is to provide that for them so that they can make decisions that will be best for their family, for their communities. And so that's why I got into it. And so that's why this whole idea of building trust, this idea of being willing to be transparent and have a relationship and engage with people, this works. And so it's unfortunate trust is low, but there's a way to rebuild it. And a lot of that is with those relationships and through transparency. So I haven't worked in a newsroom for, I guess it's been 6 years now, but still try to do some freelancing when I can, and also just love supporting journalists and trying to help the information space be a little better. Okay, so we're 5 minutes after. So I think let's go ahead and start. Again, my name is Lynn Walsh. I'm the assistant director at Trusting News. This is for module one. And just a couple reminders here, we are recording this video. We're recording it because it will be available for you and others to watch afterward, and it'll be available in module one. The other thing I want to say, which hopefully, Nana, this might answer your question, this is an asynchronous course. That means that if you feel like you're falling behind, you weren't able to complete something, that's okay. You can come back to it. So this will all be here for you. within the course, and the materials are here for you to come back to. If you are following along with us live for the next couple weeks, we love that as well. And hopefully, you know, you can participate in some more of these live discussions. So I'm not sure if anyone has questions. Again, I'm here to first open it up. If you have questions about the work for module one, specifically around transparency, specifically around getting on the record with a mission statement and explaining how your election coverage works, I'm here to answer those. You can use the chat or you can raise your hand. So I'll give it just kind of a couple minutes. I know I see, Nana, your questions. You said you took the quiz earlier. Did not see the discussion board. Just want to make sure you completed all the required assignments. Jessel, do you know, I think if you took the quiz, that's one step to completing everything. Is there anything else anyone should be doing for each module to make sure they're completing everything?
Yeah, I think Camilla from Knight Center is on. I'm not sure if she's available to answer that question directly, but I will double check as well on my end, and just to make sure that is correct.
Thank you.
Hi guys. So, what you need to do to complete every requirement is participate in the quiz and also in one discussion forum for each module. And you can find the discussion forums under module one. There's a section that says discussion forums, and you can pick one of the three that are available.
Great. Thank you so much, Camilla. And Nana, hopefully that answers your question. Has anyone began? Oh, it does answer your question. That's great. So there's another question from Vernette and asking if there is one module per week. So yes, that is the pace that this course is set up for. So if you're taking it kind of live with everyone and you want to stay up with that pace, that would be one module a week. But remember, this is asynchronous. So that means that you can, let's say you have a busy week, aren't able to get to something, you can come back to it. There will be videos recording the live Q&A, like you're participating in here, will be recorded for you to review. So if you fall a little bit behind, please don't let that stop you from fully participating. And then Camilla, there is another question. Is there a certificate at the end? I don't know if you could talk about the certificate and how they can qualify or earn that.
Yes, so there is a certificate at the end, and to obtain the certificate, it's you will need to make the quiz and get at least a 70 on each quiz for each module, and also participate in the discussion forums, as well as view the videos and do the readings. And the certificate would be available after you accomplish all of that.
Great, thank you. Great, and okay, so as we're going back to module one, talking about getting on the record about your goals and your mission of your election coverage, I'll just kind of quickly talk about, I know this is covered in the training and some of this is included, but I'll just kind of go over again why this is important and how we know that this builds trust. And then I'd love it if you have specific questions or you're curious about how exactly to do this or just kind of struggling with what this might look like, ask the question. That's what we're here for today. And let me know. So you can put that question in the chat or you can raise your hand and we can get to you that way. So the whole idea and kind of a basic principle of distrust in news. A lot of distrust in news is based on the fact that people don't know how journalism operates. This is especially true when it comes to topics like politics, other topics that might be very controversial that people have very strong opinions about one way or another. People will make an assumption about why you are covering a specific candidate, why you are covering a specific topic, and they're going to basically assume the worst. They are not most of the time going to assume that you are working to be careful, that you are trying to be accurate, that you care about fact checking. Instead, they're going to assume that you are working to push an agenda, push a political agenda. All of these things, maybe you've heard from people in your community, that you are pushing for one candidate or another. You want one candidate to win or over another. That's why you cover them all the time. Or that's why you do positive stories versus negative stories about another candidate. So that's where a lot of this distrust comes from. It comes from an assumption. Generally, people make a negative assumption about our goals. So the idea here is that you are working to build trust by interrupting that assumption in providing people with actual information about why you are doing what you are doing. When will you cover candidates? How will you cover candidates? Yes, we fact check. Where does information come from? All of these things that seem very basic to us because we do it all the time, but people don't understand that. So we need to explain. Here's how we fact check. Here's where information comes from. Here's when we're going to cover candidates. Here's what races we're going to cover. We may not be able to cover every race locally, or we may not be able to cover the national races because we're a local news organization, right? And so the idea is by explaining this, you're filling the information void and potentially preventing someone from making a negative assumption about your work. You're getting on the record about your goals and your mission. And here at Trusting News, we know that doing this, this type of transparency, getting on the record about goals and mission, can build trust. It helps people find your work more credible, more truthful, have more context. They think you're more reliable. It's more useful, right? Those are all good things. Those are things that can lead to trust. So we hope that, especially with the busy election season coming up all around the world, we are doing this work now, because you don't want to be scrambling to do it as a week before the election. Kind of get this, get it published, and then share it often when you have people's attention. That's the idea. So that's kind of a quick summary around the premise of this, how we know this works. And I'm not sure if anyone has any questions. Okay. We have a, Jessel has a comment in here. Newsrooms can't cover. Yeah. So they need to be transparent on who they will cover and why. Exactly. Like, the other thing is that, you know, we want to be realistic and honest with our community about, unfortunately, if you have a smaller newsroom staff with newsroom cuts, we cannot do it all. Maybe we can't do as much as we used to do. So explain that. Explain what you are focusing on. Because if you don't, so let's take this Maryland example that Jessel just brought up. If someone really likes one of those dozens of local of candidates running for a local office, but you're not covering them because they don't really meet the threshold of even being able to potentially win the race, they're going to assume you don't like the candidate and you don't want the candidate to win. As ethical, responsible journalists, that's not the case. We're not deciding, if we're an ethical, responsible journalist, who we want to win and who we don't, and that's who we cover. Instead, we're deciding, you know, they actually, it's very unlikely that they are going to win. So that's why instead we're focusing on these three candidates. We have to say that. Otherwise, people who like the candidates we're not covering think we don't want them to win and we're favoring the others. I'm not sure if people, let's see, I don't see any questions or hands. Again, you can raise your hand. You can put something in the chat. Something else I'll just say is people might be thinking about a question or maybe considering if there's something that they want to ask. A question we get often is like, when should you be transparent about this work, or what kinds of things should you explain? So something to think about is, a lot of times when people are confused about news, about journalism, about how you do your jobs, they're not going to ask a question about it. Often this comes across as a criticism. They might be attacking your work. So one way to think about what to write about or what to explain is to look at, what kind of feedback am I getting? Even if it's negative, And can I turn that feedback into an opportunity to explain myself, to explain my work? So if someone says, you're only covering this candidate because you want them to win, well, you can turn that into an opportunity to say, here's how we decide how to cover candidates. Here's how we decide which candidates to cover. That's a question you can answer. Again, these are not going to come across most likely as questions. People are going to come across as kind of that criticism, maybe some negative feedback. So look at that as an opportunity to explain yourself, to get on the record about your goals and your mission. Ideally, you do this publicly, and that's why we talk about creating a mission statement, creating an FAQ, because then you can continuously link to it. You can continuously have it ready to respond to people, and you can continuously empower your whole newsroom to use those explanations to talk and explain some of the reasoning. So a lot of times we also find that if you write a mission statement about your goals around election coverage and other coverage in your newsroom, you have answers to questions about how do we choose which candidates to cover. Once that's public, it empowers the whole newsroom to say, you know what? Someone might have just emailed me, or they just responded to me on Facebook about my story. I now feel empowered to explain how we're making these decisions because guess what? We publicly answer that question over here. That's going to make it more likely that more people are seeing your mission, are seeing you on the record about how you do care about being responsible and about being ethical. Yes, Fritz. And go ahead, you should be able to unmute yourself, or you can use the chat, but go ahead if you want to unmute yourself and ask the question.
Hi. Sorry. No, I have a question because that's a very interesting aspect, right, on what to share. But my question is rather towards when to share, well, when to share and how. Because I've had this situation, for example, in El Salvador now during the elections, that a lot of the things are, well, if criticism comes, one can respond to it or one has a mission statement. But in the field, I've made the experience that it's kind of difficult because people make these assumptions very quickly, depending on what you wear or what their ideological leaning is. So how would you manage that? Like, how would you, and in what way would you be transparent with someone like that? Or how would you explain your mission statement in a short or, yeah, in this kind of, in a field kind of heated moment situation?
Yes. So that's a great example, because if you are in a position where you are coming into contact with people who are maybe, again, not asking you about how you're covering, but maybe making an accusation about how you can cover, say, you know, hey, could I actually, if you have a minute, I actually would love to explain to you how we decide who to cover, how I decide what information to include. Do you have a minute though? I always kind of like to start a conversation with saying, do you have a moment for me to explain this? If they do, I like to say, you give people kind of the benefit of the doubt that they want to learn. I know this is not always the case, but I like to take that approach. So if you start it and they say yes, and they let you have the conversation, take a couple minutes and basically explain what would be written on the website or what you would write on the website if it doesn't exist, right? One-on-one. Now, if you don't have time to have a long conversation, make sure they know that. If the person is responding well, being polite, listening, and wants to follow up more, maybe if you have time, you offer that. You offer a phone call. Maybe you offer something over Zoom. If you feel comfortable, maybe offering to meet for coffee or something. Again, you want to make sure safety is something you're thinking about. If the person isn't responding well and starts attacking you more, is like, oh, I'm not going to believe your lies, just say, look, I really am trying to help provide accurate information. If you would want to talk about that more, I'm willing, but it doesn't seem like you are right now. So I'm going to continue with the work I'm doing. So I don't know if that helps, but that's kind of how walking through. And one thing we find at Trusting News is that there are a lot more people in the middle who are actually willing to have these conversations. The other thing you can do too is if they bring up something and make an accusation about your work, say, can you tell me something specific? Like, do you have a specific story that you're referring to? Is there a specific instance? Because I want to make sure I'm understanding what exactly you're talking about, so I might be able to explain how that worked. So getting to specifics can really help too.
So about the situation that I my specific
Yeah.
situation. Okay. Well, in El Salvador, I had it just so basically also a lot of the opposition to Bukele didn't show up for the elections because of the way that they perceived it would be covered. So, and there were a lot of then, and the thing is the core of this is as well that there is this type of coverage, right? There's this type of very unbalanced coverage. And you're basically standing in a bunch of people all with a camera, and seven of those 10 people are pro Bukele reporters from El Salvador. Others, there's two or one that's kind of again, but extremely against. So you have this that you are running around with them, and they ask you straightforward, like, oh, are you pro or are you anti? So I had that, but more where it became more violent was like in Colombia, for example. There, I have specific examples where you couldn't really get into a conversation, especially, for example, when riot police shows up. It was also during kind of a voting procedure, and when they show up or the police shows up in general, and you're basically in the press area with others that they identify as, oh yeah, you're left wing or you're right wing, and there's little conversation you want to try to explain to them, but you can't because they're not responsive, or they're also not very listen. They're not really, they don't want to listen. So it's kind of this, you're caught between the crossfires, and I'm wondering how to be transparent in those situations, right? Because yeah, and I had these experiences, and I mean, I can't really go too specific because those situations are pretty normal, I guess. But yeah, I think I hope there was
Yeah.
specific.
No, I think it is. And I think, again, first and foremost, you want to make sure you are protecting like yourself and your safety. And so I think it sounds like you've been able to tell, okay, this is a situation where as much as I really want to explain myself, I don't think this is going to be helpful. Like, this is not actually probably smart and in my best interest. And I think you have to listen to that instinct, you have to trust that instinct, and you have to not try to push it or move forward so you put yourself in danger. So it sounds like you are doing the right thing there. And I know that's frustrating. I know that's disappointing. It's maddening. It can be just terrible. It makes you feel terrible. You want to do more. Unfortunately, that might not be the spot to do more. Maybe, though, when you are not in that situation where you're potentially being threatened, you are able to have a conversation when things aren't, tension isn't as high. We look as that at that as a win. Fortunately, with some of this work, it's not always going to be a win. You're going to have to maybe not be able to take that opportunity to add that explanation or that transparency, especially face to face in high tension situations. The other thing that you brought up that is really important to point out, we get lumped in. If you are a responsible, ethical journalist, you're being lumped in with those people that may not be, that have an agenda, that are purposefully spreading information that might not be accurate or that has an agenda. So that is good to understand. And we have to recognize people are looking at us all as the same. And so when someone complains about the media or all the reporters here, say, you are right. There are some people here that probably do not have your best interest in mind. There are some people here that are not doing what I would consider accurate ethical reporting. But here's what I can tell you I'm doing. And I can talk to you about my work. And I can give you suggestions on where to go if you are truly interested in getting information that is accurate and that is ethical and responsible.
Thank you very
I
much.
hope that's helpful.
That
Yeah.
was very
Thank you for the
clear.
question. Good. There's another question here from Jenny. And I'll go ahead and read it, unless Jenny wants to unmute themselves. But If not, okay, Jenny, I don't hear you, so I'm going to read your question. If one candidate makes clear that they would work to, say, disassemble protections to journalists, how do you draw lines between ethical and unethical coverage without downplaying the risk to ourselves and the public? So this is where, if there is a topic that you are covering, and you as either an individual or as a newsroom do have a stance on this. So this is a good example. Thank you for this, Jenny. Where you believe that journalists should be protected. People have a right to a free press, for the press to speak freely, have a right to information. This is something that you can say right off the top. So you're going to say, here's this candidate. They say they want to do X. The things that they're proposing would do this. Me, Jenny, or myself at this news organization, we believe that you have a right to information, and so that journalists should be protected. We will still share with you what this person is saying, but we want to be clear, we do not support that. We do, in this case, have a bias, not necessarily against this person, but what they are trying to do, and here is why. If you can tie that to the importance of the community. So it's not about, oh, they're attacking me, the journalist, or how this is going to hurt me as a journalist. It's about, this is what that would mean for you, the public. If journalists can't freely report, your access to information decreases. You may not be able to hold public officials accountable. Here's why that's bad. Anytime you can tie it to the community and the impact it could have on them, that will potentially help you build trust, build credibility. Because again, we're not making it about ourselves. We're making it about the impact it has on the community. So I hope that helps, Jenny. And I don't know if you want to add more context or you have more to that. But if you do, I'd be glad to hear it.
Yeah, that's actually a really useful answer. I really appreciate that. Thanks so much.
Oh, great. I'm very glad to hear that. We have another question in here about, this is from a Kenyan journalist. It's here in the chat. Experience covering elections in environments where trust between media is broken and the situation is volatile. What would you advise to build trust and safeguard the safety of journalists? The trust between the media and the public is broken. Okay. So this, unfortunately, is something that exists around the world. Trust is low. Trust in news and trust in journalism is low around the world. This is something that a lot of countries have in common. It is worse in some countries than others, more volatile in some countries than others, greater risks in some countries than others. But for most of us as journalists, we are dealing with a lack of trust. So one way to do that is to understand why this distrust exists. Like, why don't people trust us? A lot of times, again, it's because they don't understand how we operate, how we do our jobs. If we can take some of that criticism, take some of those complaints, and use it as an opportunity to be transparent and provide some context and some answers and some information about how we do our jobs, that can help. The other really big part of this, which is not covered in this module, but is something that we talk about at Trusting News, is the importance of engagement. And that will be covered later on in this course, the importance of hearing from your community, hearing from, like, why don't they trust you? What do they wish you were doing differently? We as journalists need to be willing to hear that feedback, listen to the community, take what they say, take it back to our newsroom and say, you know, are there things we could be doing differently? Are there things we could be doing better? Could we improve by doing some of what the audience is saying? Maybe we need to diversify our sources more. Maybe we're covering topics that don't really impact our community. Let's ask ourselves that. And then potentially make changes to reflect what the community needs to help them better succeed. That listening and that engagement can help to build trust. And again, that's not something here that is in module one, but it will be covered later in this course. And we at Trusting News have other resources on it. And you will be learning here in a couple weeks. So I hope that was helpful. Any other questions people have?
Lynn, I just wanted to add on what your point about the skills being all interrelated, like being able to be transparent and build trust with your audience is essential to engagement. And it's also really essential to solutions reporting and to doing and to having conversations that are depolarizing. And those are the things you're going to be learning about in the next few weeks. So we're really glad to have Lynn share this expertise with everyone, because this is really helpful and really essential. And as we've learned through the fellowship that we run together called Advancing Democracy, these, it's not just like, they don't just sound like they would work well together. Like newsrooms actually have found that when you combine these practices, they can have really powerful impacts.
Yeah, thank you for adding that. And I think sometimes this work, it definitely seems overwhelming. Like when a newsroom's like, to the question even, I think, you know, what would you advise to build trust? Like when, at what point does the trust building exercise begin? It can seem overwhelming because we're saying, do all these things, right? And the one thing I would say is, we know resources are limited. We know that this work can be hard to fit into current workflows that exist in newsrooms. We're trying to meet deadlines. We're trying to break news, right? Something we say is try to, can you make it bite size? So I think if you're taking this course, one way is to say, you know, we're going to start with putting these skills into just our election reporting. But then once you get into the groove and you're used to being transparent, you're used to getting on the record, you're used to asking your community for feedback about what they want to think about or what they want to know about the election, now you can apply that elsewhere to other coverage. You can apply that to other beats. And then it kind of becomes baked in to everything your newsroom is doing. But please do not get frustrated and think, oh, I can't do all of it. I'm not going to do any of it. Take what you can, try little pieces of it, and build from there. Even those little pieces can be helpful and can make a difference. There's a good question here that just got sent to me about how, what if you don't belong to a newsroom? So if you're working for yourself, if you freelance, the question is, can you make a mission for yourself and for your work? And is this something you can post to your website? Yes, please do. This absolutely is something that you can post and create for yourself. If you have your own website that talks about who you are, that talks about some of the work and some of the experience you have, that is a great place to say, my goals as a journalist are, when I choose stories with the goal of doing X, right? Explaining that and creating your own mission can be so powerful. Now, ideally, if you write that down and take some time to think about it, maybe you put it on your website. Then the question is, okay, where else can you put it? Well, try to see if the publications you work for, when you add it, a lot of times when publications have your stories, there's a bio about you or on the website or attached to the story. Can some of that language get added in to the bio? Can you say, part of my goal is as a reporter is to be helpful, is to be useful, is to provide people with information on topics they care about, whatever part of that mission is. Get that into bios. See if you can get that added to the stories when they publish. Add it to your social media profiles. Link to it so that all of that can be included and people can find it. The other thing about this work is that, let's say you have that report or mission statement on your own personal website. That is great. That is a good first step. But we need to get it into content people are consuming when they're consuming it. So think about, how can I share it on social media? How can I make sure it's on my social profiles? How can I see if it's part of that bio that's listed at the end of a story? So I hope that is helpful. Oh, the bottom of an email signature. Yes, that would be amazing. Add it to the bottom of an email signature. That is great. Okay, let's see. There's another question here. I'm just reading it. Bilingual reporter in Colorado. The situation we are facing right now, the influx of immigrants and refugees have been coming to Denver, and the issue is becoming a political one now more than ever. What are your suggestions when you're reporting about the complexity of immigration, shedding light on the nuances with respect and distance when you have your own story of immigration? Do you use it or not include it? Does that make sense? Yes. Great, great, great question. Especially when it comes to trust. So something else we know about trust is that trust is often based on relationships. It's based on people trust people they know. If you think about people you trust, they're probably people who have shown up for you over the years. You have consistency there. So there is a lot to be said in research about how if we as journalists can make ourselves seem like real people, I know we are real people, but we're willing to talk about ourselves. We're willing to show people a little bit about who we are. Again, you want to do this safely and not put yourself in danger or not reveal anything that could cause someone to come after you or find you if you are in that type of situation where there could be threats. But if you can safely share information about yourself, that is something that can help build trust. So the next question is, what's the line of sharing too much versus sharing enough that it leads to that trust, that humility, being a human, and potentially also the credibility? And there is a line, because when we think about journalism ethics, there's the idea of the conflict of interest, right? We want to avoid a conflict of interest or the appearance of a conflict of interest as much as possible. That's kind of a basic standard that we kind of all have learned throughout our journalism careers. And there is a reason for that. If you work really hard on a story and people assume that you have a conflict of interest, that you have a relationship with the business owner that you're covering, they may not believe anything about that story or anything about that topic, in this case, immigration, because they say, well, of course they feel that way because that's their friend or because they are an immigrant themselves. Even if that's not true, that appearance of a conflict can discredit all the reporting and kind of defeats the purpose of what we're trying to do in the first place, right? Which is get information to people and have them trust it and then act on it and have it be useful. So this appearance of a conflict is real and it's a real concern. But I do believe that if you have strong opinions on a topic or you have an experience, in this case, as an immigrant, that you can cover a topic fairly. You still can. People have that capability. So the question is, how do you use that to be something of credibility instead of something that potentially is used against you to be that conflict of interest? The first thing I will say is there are still going to be some people, if you are to share your story of immigration, that will probably discredit any reporting you do on immigration. I think that's a potential reality. There are other people, though, that will see it as potential credibility. It's all about how you share it, though. So I would ask you to think about, when you think about your story of immigration and covering immigration, are there things that you are trying to do differently about the coverage that you saw? Are you trying to make it more fair, bring more diverse voices? Are you trying to make it less polarizing and more about the facts? Are you trying to add more nuance? You mentioned nuance. Maybe your goal is to add more nuance to the coverage that you have seen over the years. And the reason you feel that way is because when you were going through the process, you felt like there was not enough nuance. And so you're trying to improve that by adding nuance and adding more context. If you can explain something like that, and in a way about how you're not trying to push an agenda one way or the other, but you're trying to bring something more to the reporting based on the experience you have, that actually can be something that could build trust and add to the credibility. I know it's hard, it is a fine line, and you want to make sure you're comfortable sharing personal stories about yourself, because some people may not see it that way. They may use it as an opportunity to attack you, attack your reporting. So you do want to just kind of think about this. But I do think it's possible. So I hope that was helpful. And if it's something that you do, would love to see a link to it as you share it. One other thing I'd say just about the immigration issue, especially as we're talking about voting, these topics, they do need more nuance. Oftentimes when we as journalists cover them, we make them very polarizing, which we're going to, the last module is going to talk about polarization. So think about, instead of putting everyone on one side or another and having them fighting and battling, how can we add nuance and avoid generalizations? And that'll be something covered in the last module of this course. Yes, is there a question? Let's see. No? Greg. Okay, let's see. Conflict of interest. Shirley, sorry, the chat. Let me go back here. Shirley, this goes to what I sincerely believe is at the heart of the crisis in journalism, the self-promotion of individual versus putting the subject of the story front and center. I'm finding a lot of what you're saying, Lynn, at odds with what we need to do with finding ways to report on elections in our respective communities. Greg, I'm not sure if you wanted to, if there is a question in there, if there is, I'd love to hear more of it or kind of some clarity on that, because I'm not sure exactly what it is. You could either re-ask in the chat or unmute yourself. I'd love to try to address it. In the meantime, Burnett has something. There is an inherent bias that we have based on our experiences with a particular issue. In building trust, should you expose your own experience or just be aware of how your bias influences your coverage? So, great question. This idea that our experiences shape how we view the world is absolutely a true one. It exists. It is something we all come from different backgrounds that are going to have us viewing what's interesting, what we want to cover, our opinions of things differently, right? So it's a real thing. We should absolutely be aware of those. How can we be aware of that more often? Being aware of it, asking ourselves questions about it, talking to others about it in the newsroom can be a first step. As far as sharing that publicly, if you want to share your experience, let's go back to the example that someone brought up of being an immigrant or going through the immigration process. If you are comfortable sharing that and want to, I do believe there are ways to do it, but you want to make sure that you again are ready for potentially people to not be, or to assume that that bias exists and not trust anything you do moving forward. That is a risk. I think if you can start with being aware and realizing how your biases and how your experiences influence your coverage, that's a good first step. Then it's how can you have conversations with others who might have differing views that are in the newsroom. Maybe you start there, then maybe you move to outside the community.
I just wanted to add that I'm really glad we're having this specific conversation, because in module three, we speak with Natalia Contreras of VoteBeat, who herself is an immigrant, and she decided to take on this beat of reporting on elections in Texas because a couple years ago, because that was the first election she was able to participate in as an immigrant. And she did that, her own journey of of understanding all these processes, which are, you know, different in every county and every state. And so she actually leveraged that, her own experience, to tell a really powerful story and to make that her beat and do it in a really unique way. So I think I absolutely agree, Lynn, that there are ways to be transparent and to build trust and to be relatable and to really share your individual insight. And I think that's really powerful. And yeah, and so in module three, we'll get to hear from Natalia Contreras about her own reporting and why she decided to be upfront about that.
That's amazing. And Virgil just added, just kind of adding to the question, you know, that Virgil saying they personally try to be upfront about anything that others would think impacts my ability to report honestly, and then express that I'm open about it for transparency. And I emphasize that I value truth over agendas and always try to approach topics as fairly and objectively as possible. I love that. I think, you know, what we find is that kind of humility. So that's what we would call humility. You're willing to say, I know that, which I think is hard for journalists and for newsrooms, I potentially have limitations here. Here's what I'm trying to achieve, though. Here's what you should know about it as well. Here's what we're still learning. Here's what we don't know. That kind of humility can go really far, and people have a lot of respect, and it can really build trust and relationships with people. Again, there still might be people who see that and think, oh my gosh, absolutely not. I cannot trust that person. I don't believe what that person's saying. So you're always going to have some people who might be like that. But I really do believe in some of the work that we have done has shown that there are more people in the middle who are willing to, who one, want to hear from you, want to see that humility, and it can help lead to credibility and good conversation, constructive conversation, which is better than people yelling at one another or adding to the polarization that unfortunately exists more and more around every topic. Okay, so Greg kind of clarified his question here, and he's saying, I appreciate the challenge of what you are proposing. And I guess I'm teasing out my thoughts and experience of covering challenging topics in my community. How do we find the pathway to covering issues where we are not the story and the subject is? Journalism, as I see it, appears to be dominated by individuals with large egos and overdeveloped sense of themselves, injecting themselves into the story they are covering or telling us about. So Greg, yes, okay, now I understand your question and your point a little bit better. Thank you. Sorry, it took me a little bit to get there. So what I'm saying when I'm talking about building trust and being willing to share a little bit about yourself or maybe talk about your experience as it relates to the story at hand, I'm not necessarily saying you make yourself the story. Now, in some cases, journalists have done that, and that potentially can work well. That is one way to do it. I do believe if you are doing that, though, there's enough opinion coverage out there. So you don't want to necessarily, personally, I don't think, do it in a way that you're adding being another talking head on TV. Instead, you can use it to explain how you're trying to understand something, how you're trying to get people better information, right? If that's the goal, that is stuff that can be so helpful, so powerful. That is what communities want and need. So if you can do that, you're sharing something about yourself. Yes, you may be inserting a little bit about yourself into the story, but it's not about, oh, look at me, here's my opinion. It's, I have this experience. I'm now trying to help others who also had the experience better navigate the elections, better navigate the healthcare system, better stand up for themselves when facing a company that's trying to hurt them or whatever the situation might be. So I think there is a way to do it. I do agree with you that personally, I think there's too much opinion, too many talking heads in news right now. And so not necessarily saying that we should be doing more of that, but that instead our experiences can actually be an opportunity to build credibility and to allow people to see us as relatable and want to build relationships with us. But you want to do it in a way that still is serving the community, which I really do believe is the goal of what we're doing as journalists. And I'm not sure, we have just 9 minutes left. If there are any last minute questions, please feel free to add them to the chat. While you may be thinking about them, I'll just go over a couple things again. This is being recorded. This will be available in module one for you to watch later. The other modules will continue as the weeks go on. You have an opportunity to participate in real time, or remember, this is asynchronous, so that means if you do feel as if you are falling a little bit behind and you want to catch up, or you take 2 weeks to jump back in, that's okay. You'll have recorded videos. You'll have the materials there available for you to take at a later date. I'm not seeing any other questions.
And I just wanted to just to add that there was a few videos for the introductory module and an interview for module one that weren't uploaded when the course launched, but they are all being uploaded now, and you'll all get a message when those videos are available. And so you don't want to miss those. And thank you everyone. And I'm Jessel Knorr with Solutions Journalism Network. And I'll be present. I'm in office hours and be available. I'll be out along the way. So I'm looking forward to working with everyone here.
Great. Well, thank you everyone. I really appreciate the time. I really appreciate the questions. I hope the information was helpful. If you do end up sharing or creating a mission statement or an election FAQ, your own reporter mission statement, please feel free to send it along. I'd love to see it. And then also check out other resources that we have at Trusting News. So thank you. Good luck. It's important work. And we can do this together.